On behalf of Common FBC, I'd like to welcome you all to our March talk. And thank you all so much for coming. It's freezing cold out there tonight. But thank you for coming and giving us your support. And it's great to see some new faces as well. I think there are maybe a few Tom Groovies. He's just been showing me some photos. Talking about you supporting us, the more support we have, the better. And thinking of Jan, he probably has membership forms. So when you're on your cup of tea and some home baking after the talk, if you've not joined us and would like to, please see Jan. Membership is free, but the more support we have, the more credit we have, the more we for funding or anything like that. Anyway, my main purpose here is to welcome our speaker, and it's a great pleasure to welcome and introduce Kalamia Maciver, known to most as Tom, and to welcome him home to Ski the Lark.
Thank you.
As most people here will know, Tom was brought up in Upper Col and Broadway View, but then he defected some years later to the West. So, amongst other things, Tom is very well known for his comparing talents, his acting, his regular column in FIS, the next paper, but tonight he's going to look back at the story of community drama in which he was greatly involved. And very sadly, community drama groups are for the most part a thing of the past on the island and in other places as well. There's not the same community drama groups that there were 20, 30, 40, 50 years ago. I'm just thinking back myself. I remember being in a group in school, and that's a long time ago. But anyway, we look forward to Tom taking us all on a trip down memory lane to the days of community drama in Bach and beyond.
Thank you. Fesgyrma, a ys ffal tor o fwyl. Ha mis mwyn o'ch gymryd â yma chi na nyn i'n ffosglun yn o'n as y galig. O'r se galig y fain y fas yn y jolof hwyll fa mi gianw ond yn rama. Chwyd y smw ac y coi yw. Ac ys ga nyn i'ch ydw yn ar dŵl ar mi hiatwyr sy'r iaf, Donny Fochan, dŵl mae chi lehyn i'r colf. Ha mis mwyn o'ch gymryd â yma fas o'ch jawm o'ch asym. Na'n hors i chi'n as y fiol. San as y fiol a dwi'n lach yma chwyd ysmw i anw. Ach, san y fiachar i brosnwch o'i chan yn y fasin i, nad y fasin i anw drama, y ffwych neu hilan agos y ffwych y rioch, agos si rwt mi ar y ffaliwch as y fi ac am safon, agos chwyd a siachod ymwydoch yn eich hwn, agos i am mi yn hwaf as charigen, y ffwych alapus neu hilan, agos fa cordrwm magar i iddw. So tonight, I don't like this word lecture. I'm not a lecture guy. The only lecture I've ever done was to my two sons, and it didn't really work out very well. No. But I look on a lecture as a structured speech with data and information and dates and accuracy and some guy with a specialist subject and that kind of thing. It's not what I have tonight. I would look on it more as a long yarn than a lecture, because that's really what it is. And thank you for the introduction. It usually takes me 20 minutes to introduce myself, so that's out of the way. So we'll get on with the community drama. And I suppose you would need to ask the question from another thing I would like to emphasize is that I'm not here tonight to talk about me, because that's not what community drama was. Community drama was about drama teams. There were no stars. We worked together, we did everything together, and it wasn't about any one person. So it's not about that. There's a lot of people involved in it. But where did it start? Well, I don't know. I got the name Tom because I was very, very shy. Most people who knew me as a lad, I would be the last person on earth they would expect to see standing in front of an audience tonight or anywhere else because of this shyness. I was a very, and then again, I don't know, because people said I was. There was a cousin of my mother, she used to come on, Cutie, remember Cutie? She used to come to our house and she'd say, oh, call me Anya Grice, I'm shy. And I think I thought, aye, I must be shy, you know. And when I was approached by an adult, I used to hang down. And there was a song in the popular music charts called Hang Down Your Head, Tom Dooley, right? So this the Ian Mulder, Yona and Gabby, Mac Gully and Sheen, has started calling me Tom Dooley. I guess I love Dooley. I guess Goodish Tom. So that's where it came from. But I had no, you know, and I remember, as far as drama was concerned, I remember going to the old back hall, the wooden hall, which was down where Vatasker Park is now, to a concert. And I remember that there was a very promising young piper there called Ian Mulder Morrison. The MC was a guy called Basher from town. And there was a comedy sketch. And the only thing I can distinctly remember about it was that Eric Ian Oscar was in it. And she was wearing one of these pinafore things, you know, with an apiana. And she was sweeping the stage and people were laughing, you know. And I thought, that's great, you know. But I didn't rush home and say to my father, I want to be an actor, you know. But then I saw a film called The Square Peg, starring a comedian called Norman Wisdom. And the Highlands and Islands Film Guild used to come round the halls then and show films. And I remember in the kitchen at my house at 17 Broadbayview back, imitating Norman Wisdom to my father. I can still see them, my father and mother at the end of the table, and me doing Norman Wisdom, and they were laughing. And for this shy little boy, it felt good. There was something, I was making them laugh. It's not that we didn't laugh at all, but I was the reason for the laughter, you know. And again, I didn't rush out and I want to be, no, it didn't happen like that. But something did happen because a group started in back. It was formed by a lady called Marudana Hjörsjövicani, right? And I don't know how it came about. I remember we used to meet in the hut down in the playground there. The last time I was in here, Duncan Morrison was playing the piano. We used to meet in this little hut down here and rehearsals. And Kenyoch was there. I've got a photograph here of the cast. And this is from the Gazette way back in the day. And it says, Back Drama Group B are photographed after a performance in the Gaelic play in Hoahalan, Muddled Motherhood, at the local drama festival. And this is the cast, back row, left to right, Margaret Ann McCaskill. Joint producer. Sounds like a drug dealer, doesn't it? Joint producer. Catherine Maciver. That's Katrina Ian Helson from Col. Sandra McKenzie. I hadn't seen her for years, but I saw her recently. Joan McLeod. Hi, Anjo. Kanyehi. Seanak there. Was in it. Mary McMillan was Ian. Ian Yiglinje from number 11. She had a brother called Statue. Joanne McLeod, the late Seanak, how am I now? She was in it. Kenneth McKeever, Kenny Honochian, and Kenneth McKeever, Bechusen, Kenyoch Moore. Donald McInnes, Don Stocky, your brother. Malcolm John McKeever, that's me. Angus McLeod, Dennis. And Norman Campbell, Banya, the late Mac Tuxey. So that was the cast. I don't remember an awful lot about this play, but Kenyoch assures me we went to Glasgow and performed it, and I'll have to believe him. But that was the beginning of it. But that group just naturally disbanded. You know, Maradona went off to Islay to get married, and people started going to college, and it just petered out naturally. And I was no part on the stage. I didn't take part in this play. I was a stage manager, which meant I carried the furniture onto the stage and off. So that that was that, and nothing really happened. But then, unknown to me, Donnie Vaughan had started a group called Nabaki out in the school there. And I knew nothing about it, and I had no interest in it, because I'd started work by the time, but I was still painfully shy. I wouldn't go into the office where the girls were in Mitchell's. I was terrible. But I had an eye for Joy Yona. Because she was handy, she was next door, you know. I didn't have to go in town to pull, you know. A Callahan's touching in Yance, you know. So it was handy, you know. But there was more to it than that, of course, you know. But she was in this group, and she used to go a couple of nights a week to this rehearsal things, and I thought, what are you going there for? That's no, come on down, we'll go for a walk to the Clatter. Well, no, I'm going, I'm involved in it. And if you want to be with me, you'll have to come along. And I went. The next thing I knew, I was standing in the rehearsal in the middle of the floor with a script playing a lawyer. That's the kind of guy Donnie Vaughan was. You know, he didn't ask you, do you want a part in my play? Sure, and he was, that was it. With the pipe, you know, and that was it, you were in. And that was it. That's how it all started. And then I remember we performed a play. I don't remember, Cunioch remembers doing this play and going to Glasgow with it. I think you said that earlier on. That's very faint with me. But the first one I remember is a play called Fríamh Go Chulainn, which was Cunioch translated it from English. It was written by a guy called Sean O'Casey. And it was an Irish player, and Cunioch translated it into Gaelic, and we performed it as Nabaki. And the story of the play was two drunk guys coming into the post office wanting a pound out of the book. And I was one of the drunks. And it was hilarious. It was so funny. I got so much pleasure out of playing this part, because I can still remember Donnie Vaughan, his sister Chrissy and Kitty sitting at rehearsals laughing. You know, something was happening at every rehearsal. We used to rehearse in Mohan's house. You had to pay for the school, we didn't have money. I remember rehearsing in Ian Mast's house. He used to clear the kitchens for us and let us rehearse in there. And then we got a trip to Glasgow. Now, Cathy Morag was the blown. I was coming into the post office for the pound with my mate, and she was the one behind the counter. And she was so good, she was so funny, but she couldn't keep a straight face. It was fantastic. It was a lovely, lovely time. And we did this Fríamh Go Chulainn, and we took it to Glasgow. And anyway, there was they took us away to Glasgow. I hadn't even been to Loughs. And all of a sudden, seriously, I'd never been to Point, and here I was in Sophie Hall. But we used to have to carry our own furniture, and it was stage door flats, and they were 8 feet tall by 4 feet, and they had a real door in them, or a real window, and we had to cart them onto the Lough Seaforth, up the gangway, find a place for them, take them off the Lough Seaforth at Kyle, put them into the guards van on the train, find a place, then carry them to the Highlanders Institute. But we didn't, we were innocents abroad, we didn't know. Is that a skyscraper? No, it's a double decker. You know, we didn't have a clue. Getting to Glasgow then was probably the equivalent of going to the moon nowadays. Seriously, it wasn't. But I remember a couple of instances that have been well told during these trips. I remember going up the gangway one day, myself and Ramsay were the flats one night. Ramsay was at the front and he was struggling. And along came Captain Smith, the captain of the ship. Remember him? Came along the gangway. Clear gemach sa rat arno chan hai neoch a falaf an och. And he lifted the flats and... And the lawyer standing there goes... So we used to stay, we had no money. We used to have sailor works in the school to raise money. We couldn't afford accommodation, but we stayed with relatives. Everybody had relatives in Glasgow then. I stayed with my sister, Ishbal, and Ramsay stayed with relatives on Peel Street, and Joy Yona stayed with her sister. And we arrived at Queen Street Station this time. We're doing a play called Aisht, which Seanach was in. There's a coffin in it. And we were doing the play called Frein of Cachulc, and there was a policeman in it. And we couldn't get a van to take our stuff from the railway station to the hall, to the Highlanders Institute. So we decided to hike it. So we're walking down with a coffin. And Ramsay at the front with a policeman's hat. Didn't care. Innocence abroad, no problem. These two guys came up, plainclothes cops, stop. What's going on here? So Cathy Ann Yona had met us. She was living in Glasgow. She was streetwise. We didn't have a clue who these guys were. And she explained to them what was going on. And the guy said, it's okay, that's fine, but you cannot wear a policeman's cap in public unless you're a cop. The only way you can wear it is there was a brooch in the middle of the cap, and you had to remove that if you're wearing it in public. Take that out, on you go. And the next day, now I think it was me and Cunioch Moore, he won't admit to it because he's a radio star, but I think it was me and Cunioch Moore. Donny Vaughan said to her, we were playing labourers in this play, we were drunk, you know. He says, your clothes aren't dirty enough. We had done dungarees and wellies and the bonnet biloch and the popangensis. They're not dirty enough for effect. You're on tonight. There's a demolition squad walking down the road. Go down there and get some dust onto your gear and dirty yourselves up. Galashin, she is with a bonnet biloch and sochi. Why not? My old man did it. His old man did it. She is a rat. We reached the demolition site. There's a big crane there with a ball on it knocking tenements off. Men all over the place who went down on their knees on the side of the road and started throwing. The place ground to a halt. The crane stopped. And this guy came over. And it's the first time I ever heard this phrase. What seems to be a soapy bubble here? The next time I heard it was from Billy Connolly. And we explained to him what we were doing and I says, that's fine. And he explained to us there was an asylum up the road. And he mentioned something else I'd never heard of, a yellow van and the men in the white coats. But that was the kind of, and we didn't know that we were competing. I don't ever remember being aware that it was competitive drama. The baggage came later. We were only 16, 17. I remember one night we were doing this Frein of Cachulc. We had performed the play. And somebody had told us about a place called Lauder's Bar, which is still there on the corner of Sohi Hall Street. And that they sold this stuff called highballs. Oh, yes. I think it was more a fortune that heard about it. So we went and we got in. We were only 17 and we got in. I was tall always, so I could get away with it. We got the highballs and we only had one, and off we went back down there. And as we went into the Highlanders, the adjudication had started. This was the judging. And we didn't know what it was. We just sat behind Donny Vaughan there and listened to the guy. And the next thing I heard was the award for the best comedy performance of the festival goes to Malcolm John Maciver of Nabakish. People called me Tom. I didn't know who Malcolm John. I sat there and next thing I heard, yo, shoot, this Donny Vaughan. What? Who's that? And I got this silver bowl thing, which I took home and shoved on the mantelpiece. It didn't mean a thing to me. It wasn't about competition. It was about the adventure, the enjoyment, the people. I never wanted to be an actor. An actor is Richard Harris and Dustin Hoffman, people like that. You know, I had no interest in that. It was all about people. So that was the baggage. And on it went. We had fantastic times, and Tini, bless him, was with us as well. And Tini was a fantastic guy. Tini knew everybody's lines. He was like a paperless prompter. He would listen, take it all in. He was with us first of all in the back, he was with us later in Broadbay Drama Group, and I believe he's not well, but I was going to mention him anyway. But he had this knack of, if you were ever going through your script, and he would meet you 5 years later on Cromwell Street and come out with a one of the, he knew everybody's lines. He was fantastic, and he was a great asset to the two teams. And it was a fantastic, now the Bacchic, we did then a play called An Owl. I think, Kenny, by this time you would have gone to college or university or whatever. But Donnie wrote this play called An Owl, and it's what they call a black comedy. It was funny at the beginning, and then and he wrote it in two stages, and we started, I had the lead part in it. It was about a guy who was watching too much television and he was going blind. Now Donnie had been reading a book by this guy called Kafka. I didn't know who Kafka was then, I don't really, he wrote weird stuff. So the comedy was the guy watching the telly, and it wouldn't work, came home from work and he's sitting there watching, so it wouldn't come on, and the thing was the wife hadn't, she'd pulled the plug out when she was hoovering, and that's why it wouldn't work. But then he introduced us to the black part, the non-comedy part, and he gave me the script and I read it and I said, I can't do this. This is not why I'm here. I'm here for a laugh. I like making people laugh. I like comedy. No way. I can't do it. He says, you can't do it. I can't do that, Donnie. He says, I'll show you what I want you to do, and I know that you're perfectly capable of doing it. He saw something in me, and he believed in me more than I believed in myself. And it was something like, Eist, of a loquentian car, Eist, we rape in a marriage. Struchier gaan we vooruit, niet maar het zien. En pjol van het zien gaan we hier, laat me ook van een snak het ik. Ga me vallen af, ga me taal. Had je ooit naar de huilen? Gaal. Kost je maar gaal. Konjaal, kienal, zorgaf. En niet toch, en mis ik ons niet naar maar. Ach, zo nou gaal ook geen. Wel gaal, ik mis je kutjok. En het went in, en dat was het. I was 16, and I was supposed to do this, but I did it, and I did it well, and I could tell we did it well, because the play had the black side of it. Donnie was very experienced in theatre. He had a knowledge of lighting and stagecraft that nobody else here had then. He was using ultraviolet light in our plays before anybody else had heard of it in Stornoway. He was using sound effects and stuff that was ahead of the time we were in Stornoway. Through his experience with the BBC and all that, he was able to apply this to his plays, and it was great to work with him. He was a fantastic guy, a very talented man. And he had Joey Yona. At the end of this play, when this guy was going blind, and if you can imagine the lighting, and Joey was singing live. She came in from the back with that hymn, He only could you me sanny good me, Gentrock of the man, I'm a Spanish mohem, could you me ears of the Leagun Nev. And I remember in Glasgow watching the woman in the front row weeping. And when you see that, you know you're doing something right, and it feels really good. There's nothing quite like, see, Donnie will verify this, when you're doing comedy, the Town Hall was a fantastic place to perform, and it was the best. The acoustics, the setup, the stage, the balcony, everything. And see, when you're doing comedy in there, and it's full up, there's nothing like it for a performer. There's nothing that you can get out of a bottle or out of a smoke, believe me, I tried. There's that compares with that feeling you get when you know that what you've worked hard at for weeks is working. And it's the same with the serious stuff. If you're doing a powerful speech and you can hear a pin drop, it's equally satisfying. And that was some of it. But again, it all goes back to the people. And the Bacchic evolved. You will find in life, I found that there will always be things that you'll get certain people in a certain place at a certain time doing something they love and something they're good at, and it'll be okay for a while. Everything's got a sell-by date. The Bacchic went the same way as the previous group. People went off, and it disbanded. And here you had this very good-looking, talented young man with nowhere to display his talents. And then I got a phone call from Etta Bell McMullan, from Point, who was the producer of a group that was working at a store and we called Nihilani. And she asked me if I was interested in joining their group, and I said yes. Don't know why, but I said yes. And this is when I came into contact with this cove here, Donny McInnes. We clicked right away. We became friends off stage, but we had a certain kind of chemistry on stage as well. I can't explain it, but we always knew. See, if we were preparing a play, and you ever met Donny on the street through the week when he was working for the Gazette, he would have the script. He'd have the script in his pocket because he was a perfectionist. I wasn't. And I knew that I could depend on him and him on me to a degree if anything went wrong on the stage. And quite often it did. And it's a terrifying thing when you're standing in front of an audience and you forget your words, there's nothing coming. So we teamed up with Nihilani, and Nihilani achieved something that had been never been done before, as far as I was aware anyway, by a Gaelic drama group. We had a situation then in Lewis where you had the Scottish Community Drama Association festivals. These were festivals that were for English plays, primarily, you know, that was mostly. So we were entering these festivals with Gaelic plays, and we were good. It was all about acting and production at the end of the day, but we were speaking a minority language, but we were doing well. And I can't remember when Comhain na Drama was formed, probably in the 70s somewhere, but this was an organisation under the auspices of an Comhain Gaeloch that was formed to look after us, the Gaelic speaking promoting drama groups. And that they started their own festival so that we could have regional festivals, and then you competed in them and the winners went. Now at that time there was no competitive drama at the Mod. The first competitive drama at the Mod was in Ayr in 1970-something, and I was there with Nihilani. Cunioch Moore was there with a group from Glasgow, and I remember sitting in the audience with Donny, watching them perform one of Donny MacLean's plays called Suas an Halk. And I watched that play, and I remember sitting next to Donny and turning around to him and saying, I want to do that. It was a brilliant play. And Donny Finlayson and Cunioch and two other actors played the parts, wasn't it? But we did it differently. We were good. We did the four parts, just the two of us. And it was a fantastic experience. And I remember that it was a black comedy again. It was more of a slapstick comedy. And I'm moving ahead now. I've lost my but I'm in Broad Bay Drama Group. But it was a wonderful play to do. And I remember we had to come off the comedy side of the play, go behind the curtain, change into another costume and makeup, and come back in as the monster and no comedy. And Donny Vaughan timed us with a stopwatch. Not too slow. You need to cut it. I think it was 27. He wanted 27 seconds. And eventually we got it down to 27 seconds and we did it on stage and achieved that. But anyway, to go back to Nihilani. So these festivals, we had the Gaelic festivals and we had the English festivals. And we entered them both because it was more parties, you see. You get away more jaunts. And we used to go to Broadford quite a lot, to Skye. And my parents never saw me on the stage. Never. Because their generation, drama, what's that? Yeah, they didn't mind me doing it. No interest in it. Yeah. But the Broadford festivals and the Gaelic festivals always happened at the time of the peats. Right? And my father didn't like it. He never said anything to me. But I knew, because I was going to be away for a weekend. during the peach season. Bad crack. And I remember I would come home on the Saturday night off the ferry and into the house, and he would ask, "Oh, you had an Ash, huh? How did you get a demo? I go, oh, hi, all right, who's in cop and who's in shirt, who's in shaw? Aye, aye, clever." And then you would get this pause. And then you would hear, "Hamonia the Tokal." Yes. But he never said, I found out later in life that he was quite proud of what I was doing, and that was nice, you know. But he never said it himself, he was that kind of guy, you know. But in the Hillanish, anyway, we Donnie and I became the two main actors in the Hillanish. I say that because that's the way it was. Modesty and humility shining through. And we performed this play by Taramut Callum Donlo from Garagurum and Norman MacDonald. Mac Braha Shores Yonlai. He had come home from London, he was working here and he was involved in drama, and he wrote this play in Hishchad Amards and Bolonish. And Donnie and I had the lead part in that, and we managed to get through all the stages. We were competing against the English teams in the SCDA Festival. We got through all the stages right through to the Scottish Finals in Montrose in 1970, Rutigen, I can't remember. And they didn't like it. We were a minority language speaking group, and you'll remember this, Cathy and Donnie, probably. The press got a hold of it, and I remember a paragraph in the Press and Journal, and a journalist writing, "If this is going to be allowed, can we expect to see a Harold Pinter play in Urdu?" That's what he wrote. Am I right? That's what he wrote. And we were, you know, this was the day before it went on, and it didn't affect us. We didn't give a toss of it. The Press and Journal was writing. But we didn't manage to win the finals, but it was a fantastic adventure. The finals were in Montrose, and we took part in it, and we were at a civic reception, and all the bells and mayors and everything, and famagari, if you like that kind of thing. If you like sipping glasses of sherry in the corner, which I didn't, you know. But anyway, that was in the Hillanish. The Hillanish were a big group. We had a big, Johnny Morrison was in the Hillanish as well. And it was a big, quite a big group. At one time we were able to put two plays into the festival in Stornoway. And We did things like, we put on mock weddings. We would sell tickets to the public for a three-course meal in the Crown. And the top table was us. And I married Mordak from Laxdale one night. And Donnie married her next year. It was full house, it was sold out. And we did the speeches, and we did everything. We had the telegrams and everything. And I found this whilst raking through. These are the telegrams we used at the first wedding. And they're printed on genuine telegram forms, but they were made up. And the best man made a speech, the groom made a speech. We had everything you would have at a wedding, and after the meal we had a dance. It was fantastic. This is the telegrams. I'm not going to read them all, but as an example, the telegrams were supposed to be from prominent members of the public or whatever. This is from the House of Commons. "I'm your new MP from Govan. Hope there's nothing in the oven." From Margot. Margot. That's got Donny Cassette written all over it, hasn't it? "Hope your wedding will be dandy. I'll drink your health in sherry brandy." That was from the Cove, yeah. "Watch yourself going round the bend. She's got a slipping clutch and loose begins." Kenny Coe. Kenny Coe's from Mitchell's Garage. "Tonight I thought I'd drop a line to say the honeymoon was fine. Hope you all have quite a lark. I don't care because I've got Mark, Princess Anne." Anyway, and that was... So we had concert parties. We had things called Cayley houses in the town hall, which was, the stage was set like somebody's house, and the Potter and Kayak were in, and Johnny Buck would come in Cayley and sing a song. Somebody else would come in and play the pipe. Sold out in the town hall. It was fantastic. And we did a concert party trip to Uist a couple of times. I remember the first time we went over to Uist, we were performing three nights, Thursday night, Friday night, or Wednesday, I can't remember, but we were performing this night in the Carnish Inn. And we reached the Carnish Hall, came off the ferry, the Newton ferry it was then, the Castle Moyle, the wee fishing boat, there was no cars. And we reached the Carnish Inn, and the Carnish Hall, we put our gear in the hall, and we found out there was a Carnish Inn within a couple of miles walk, so off we went. It's a piping hot day, and we're wearing these white, do you remember these white woolen jumpers that with the crew necks, with the big, everybody had them, you know, the white ones, Aran jumpers, and you're walking 2 miles in the sun. By the time we got to the pub, we were. So we reached the door of the pub, and there was this bullock in the doorway, a big black bullock with a rope round its neck, a blue nylon rope, and the rope was going up a corridor and into the right. And we've patched, and we're standing there, what are we going to do? So there's a guy from Laxdal with us called Alistair Furlag. And Roddy Buchanan was there playing the box. And we started slapping this beast, and it wouldn't move, but eventually it went, and it took off, and the rope came with it. And the guy, with a froth, and I don't know how he knew who we were, but you'll excuse me for this, he was shouting, "No, she can get." So we went into the bar, and we asked the bar, "What happened?" "Oh, he says he's one of the local lads. He's not quite, you know." "What happened?" "Well, he was standing there with his pint in his hand, and he had the rope round his waist." And so on the way back on the Saturday, we were travelling in this Castle Moyle, this fishing boat, and there was a bullock in the hold going home with us, and we were covered in a tarpaulin, and it was raining, and Roddy Buchanan was playing the box, and we had the cans of beer, and this tarava standing there, and every so often, so that was Nihilanich, and Nihilanich, it kind of evolved like the other groups. It just petered out. And meanwhile, whilst all this was going on, my good mate here, my best friend, my fishing partner, had met this bloke here. "Oh, I won't be going fishing on Saturday. I'm meeting Kathy." "Who's Kathy?" "Oh, I'm going to meet Kathy, and we're going." "What about me?" "I was gutted." And he had met Kathy, and eventually, I was very happy for them in the end. But, oh, come on, man. There's more to life than that. There are cans to be drunk and lots to be fished. So anyway, they got married during the mod in Aberdeen in 1970s. Ruth again. You'll probably remember. Yeah, 1976. And they went to Living Point, and there was nothing going on. And then they moved to Vatiska Park. And what was better than starting a drama group in Bach? So we called a meeting, the two of us arranged it, we called a meeting in the school, and a few people, I think 15 people turned out the first night, and Jam was there, Peggy, myself, yourself, Valerie, my memories. Margaret, of course, yeah. And we started Ramsey. We did a couple of English plays, didn't we? We did The Farmer's Once a Wife, which Kathy produced. And we did Old Verily. That was a disaster. I mean, it just wasn't us. So we concentrated on Donnie McLean's stuff, and we did Suas and Halk eventually. And every one of this place, there's six of them in this book, I think, or five. We did them all in the tenure of Broadway Drama Group. And Ramsey and Kathy shared the production, but we called Donnie in because he could see things that ordinary people couldn't. We would be rehearsing a play for 4 or 5 weeks and we'd call him to have a look at it. And he would let us go through the play from one end to the other, and then he would make us go through and he would stop us and change things. And they were simple things, but they were so effective. And we used to think, how on earth didn't we think of that? But he saw things that we couldn't see, and he was brilliant. And what have I got here now? We had him in to assist, yeah, and we did Suez and Halk, and that was a classic. That was my favourite ever. And Broadway went on. Valerie was there, Margaret. We went away on John's. Teeny was with us there as well. Teeny on the stage, as I mentioned, the words. But we did the host, and he was the court officer. And the host was about Patrick Seller and the Highland Clearances. And Teeny was the court officer, and I played the part of the judge, and I had to give Teeny his orders, bring in this fiend, Patrick Seller. And we'd be messing about at rehearsals, you know, having a laugh, and Teeny would into character, just like that. And he was not Teeny anymore, he was the court officer. And he would come in with a guy in here. He was fantastic. He had the face and the walk and the attitude, and he was really, and it was great to work with people on that. And this guy, my mate, as Patrick Seller, was a horrible, horrible person. And this guy played him to the point where I felt like sort of fantastic acting, you know, and it was really good. And we did it in Eden Court. I was talking earlier about fear and losing your lines. We were in Eden Court performing this, the host, with Marion Eady was the Calloch. And there was a black side to the stage and a light side. And Donnie and Marion Eady were in this light side of the stage having dialogue. Eden Court, full up, divisional part of the fest, I don't know what stage it was. And Marion lost her voice. Froze, nothing. Nothing. Eden Court. Ramsey was the producer and he was up the back with the guy who was controlling the curtains and the lights. And he was about to get the guy to drop the curtain. He saw what was going on. But we were there. We were there. And we got out of it and the play carried on and nobody knew. See, we knew the script. Nobody else did. And we got through it. We weren't successful in the competition, but that didn't matter. And that was Broadway Drama Group. And I've gone through a lot. There's a lot more, but I think, you know, the human brain can only absorb so much. And I suppose if you were to ask me, did you have a favourite play? It would be unfair to pick one. I got so much pleasure out of doing this, and it gave me a confidence and a foundation. And I've heard Cunyoch speaking about this before, that the work he does now as a broadcaster, the basic foundation that we got with Donnie Vaughan back in the day still stood us in good stead through various parts of our lives. And I found that as well. We used to have professional drama advisors to come over to the island before a festival and take us through the plays and that. And they taught you how to behave on stage. You can't do certain things on stage. You can't do that on stage. That's against the rules. You know, your mask, you can't do that. It's got to be this. Got to be that, but you've got to leave yourself open. You've got to use the stage. They were fantastic. They taught us so much. If I was going to choose a play, It would have to be Susan Halk. I think that was my favourite ever, and mainly because I was able to do it. I'd seen Cunioch and Finlayson do it, and I wanted to do it, and I did it. But other things happened. Donny and I carried on. When Broad Bay disbanded, we carried on doing sketches all over Lewis and Harris. We went to Harris 6 years in succession to the land community buyout concert. They wanted us over there, putting sketches on there. We did 6 sketches for Rondan. We were commissioned to write 6 sketches for Rondan. And it sounds easy, Donny and Tom, 6 sketches, no problem, but we had to think of 6 situations, different characters, all these lines, but the money was good, so we did it. We wrote another 8 or 10 for a series called Falcho with Grampy on television. That was round about the same time. Community drama then, something changed. Television came in. Gaelic television. Macher came in. Things like that. Society changed everything. Community drama, it's gone. I live in a community that's got a fantastic new community centre. It's got every facility that any drama group would want. It's got a state-of-the-art sound system, state-of-the-art lighting system, a portable stage. It's warm, comfortable, beautiful, brand new. And I started a drama group over there shortly after it was built. We wrote about 6 productions. We things ourselves, put them on locally, but nobody was prepared to put in the commitment to keep it going, and it went. When I went over there first, I was up in Ness with Alistair the Voxer and Tran the Voxer. We tried the same thing up there. We did 1 season, we got through divisionals in Stornoway, we went to Dingwall. Derek Pluto was part of the group, and again, it just fittered out. So Donny and I were going doing your sketches for quite a long time. We're very much in demand. And again, everything's got a sell-by date. You come to the stage where it starts to become a chore, and we agreed, there was no arguing, we both agreed that it would have to finish sometime, and we stopped it. But I had a great time. I see Valerie there as well, was it Skolhu and Nachtut Miru. Donny's plays had a great dialogue, local dialogue in them, and about the fishing and the Lian Buck and the Clatoch and the Raping and Mar and all. It's fantastic stuff. Some great actresses and actors, you know, it was real, real fun. And what did I get out of it? Well, it wasn't money anyway. But that's not why I went into it. But it was just such a pleasure to be part of it. And alongside me in Broadway Drama Group and Nihilanich, in every major town and city from Glasgow upwards, was Donny. He was my right-hand man, my inspiration, my friend, and he was with me all the way. And that's a wonderful way to live, and it's a wonderful... And I don't know how to repay that kind of friendship except by continuing to be a friend, you know. But I'd like you to do something for me just now. I would like you all to be upstanding, and on behalf of me, give this guy a huge round of applause. Please, thank you, from me. Not too much. I mean, leave some for... But that was it. We spent a lot of time together on the stage, and it was wonderful. And you've been a great audience. I didn't have a plan coming here tonight. I didn't have a structure. I just had a memory. I'm sure some of you who are around will have your own and will put me right on certain things. But I'd like to thank you for coming out of isolation. For coming out of isolation and bothering to turn up. And I hope that you enjoyed what you heard. Thank you very much.
ladies and gentlemen, I've been asked to propose a vote of thanks, and I do so without any great difficulty tonight, because many of Tom's early memories are early memories too. I heard him boasting about the fact that he got the trophy for the best comedy actor. He never mentioned it a year before that. Jesse Morrison cut one of the most promising young actors. These were times, right enough, and I was just thinking, you know, this is a coming down to come over. And Johnny telling his father, Bohan, hello, Stech, in a sitting. And on a winter's night, walking down from Colorado, I said, you know, it was amazing really how we got involved and how we got a hold of us. And funnily enough, the play you preferred most, I think, was the last play I ever took part in the 1973 mod in Ayr. I don't think I've ever taken part in a play ever since then. So I retired at an early age, but it was great to hear what you had to say there. Great to hear the influence it had in the community. And in many ways, the talent that Donnie Bohan had, that many people never really understood, apart from ourselves, who had the benefit of it. Great to see so many people here tonight. I still remember, I think I must have someone there, the picture in the Loch Seaford with Seanach, Nini and Mast, Nini Macmillan and that kind of thing. Anyway, great trip down memory lane, and on behalf of us all, thank you very much.
Thank you.
And before we finish now, the boss has told me I have to tell you that you're most welcome to come along to the AGM of the Common Estuary on the 17th of April. Is that right?
Here.
Here. I see, and I always need a prompt. You mean also? We all need a prompt. So that's it. Thank you all very much. A cup of tea here, mix, and have a look at some of Charles' work.
Yeah, thank you very much.